begin to spend. Now we need to touch about the health care. Oftentimes we see Nigerians dying because they cannot afford it. There's one law I'm going to pass. It would be against the law for anybody to show up in the emergency room and you deny them health care because of money.
So how will you ensure that this is...
No, it's going to be a problem, right? It's more important. You see, we are not valued in Nigeria. Nigerians can just die and nobody care about it. That's why you see, with all the S-men killing, the president can only be saying,
go to your message and
I'm not saying anything bad. I'm trying to
get to 141.
We need to
wait for a reply. If you get congratulations, you can enjoy 100%.
If somebody shows up in the emergency room and they need care, you have no right to be asking about money. Treat them. If they cannot pay, of course, as an organization, you write it off your tax. The government takes responsibility of it. That's the same way it's done all over the world. So,
Just keep charging $200.
Instead of allowing the person to die, give them the care that they need. And if the person cannot afford it, cannot pay for it, you are paying off your tax. I think it's protecting lives than money. Now, the idea of, I know the doctors are going to say, oh, how then do we get our money back? Nigerians will be excited that they can go to the emergency room. I'm not talking about the regular care. I'm talking about emergency room. You know this thing is about it. You don't know their family members. There's no trace. Instead of asking for deposit, I think the person needs to be treated. If you go to a place like America, for people to use that example, if you see the way the militaries are treated, you want to join the military and just go and die for your nation. When a military officer dies in the battlefield, if the president cannot go and receive him, the vice president, someone in the federal level must go and receive the body. I just landed at Lagos Airport. I saw two military officers. You know, we are conditioned to appreciate them. I said to them, thank you for your service. One of them, the lady said, for what? I said, oh, boy. For what? I'm thanking you, you're serving our country. The guy explained to him, I said, where I come from? When we see military officers, we appreciate them. They are not valid. We need to be able to put value in their life so they can go there and protect our lives very well.
How about diversifying the economy?
This girl, Emanuela.
Because this government talked about looking into agriculture. What are your plans?
The current government, they talked about agriculture during this campaign. But one thing I was expecting him to do, forgive me for going here, if you want to really focus on agriculture, you make yourself the Minister of Petroleum instead of Minister of Agriculture. Dependency on oil. Why don't we focus on agriculture? To me, it doesn't make sense. God gave it to us as a blessing. It's not a curse. So we don't have to reduce the dependency on it. Of course, from the revenues, whatever we generate from there, we can empower the farmers. Now, farmers still use cutlass to go to farm. There are things we can empower them with, little machineries that cost nothing, that we can give to them to increase their fertilizers. We need to be able to have loans for farmers. If you know, you want fertilizers, you want things that can empower them. Now, saying for agriculture, we are blessed. The weather is conducive for us. From January to December, farmers go to farm.
So do you intend focusing on agriculture or you want to focus somewhere else?
No, we're going to give attention to agriculture. It's what God has blessed us with. Like I said, the weather is conducive.
Yeah.
The weather is favorable to agriculture. Why don't we put...
All right. Okay, before we move on, before I come to you, gentlemen, I would like for us to critically watch our language. Our language and then the opinions.
International market. Just yesterday, Canada announced that they will be 30%. They will only be able to supply 30% of their needs, because cannabis is used for medicine. It's not the part of cannabis that people worry about. It's called THC. It's the part that makes people high. The rest of it is what has been around forever.
Look at all food. Coca-Cola
just signed a deal with Aurora in Canada, just to study how they can infuse cannabis for wellness. So if have a Coca-Cola, you can drink and it'll calm you down, it make you sleep better. You know, you have epilepsy, it treats it, it helps with treating cancer. And the hemp itself, the tree itself, has fibers that can be used to make clothes. It's better than cotton. In fact, there's been allegations, I mean, historical allegations, that the reason why the U.S. criminalized hemp was because the cotton moguls, people who were growing cotton, saw them as bad competitors.
Mm.
So the word has already arrived there. You know, South Africa has legalized. Yesterday also, there's some news in the U.K. that now doctors can prescribe cannabis.
Mm.
So what I'm saying to you is that if we can make $4 billion between Ekiti, Edo, Ondo, and that's Delta, the circle that grows cannabis very well, you don't need to go to the federal government to go and be begging for it, because $1 billion is how much? It's about $250 billion. There's no state in Nigeria today that can make $350 billion. I'm not saying, but we could even make way more than that. But it's, the argument is not about cannabis. It's an argument about diversification. That's what that is. It's an argument about health. My own concentration will be how to grow the Nigerian person to become a resource for the country. And I'll focus a lot on technology.
Right.
Do you know that the companies that are doing best in the world today are technological companies?
So,
you know, you have Apple, you have Amazon, and there are Nigerians out here who are producing technological software. They are part of the game already, but we are not incentivizing them. We don't have, I will appoint, for example, a chief technological officer or a chief innovation officer for Nigeria who can be looking at what young people are doing, because one person, an innovation from a person, can make this country become richer than it. I mean, Microsoft, I mean, Apple's value is bigger than Nigeria's annual.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You understand? So just one person took the country to that level. We need to invest. That's why we keep saying invest in education so that you can produce citizens who can go out there, innovate, and compete in the world. So there's a lot we can diversify. Oil is a lazy economy. In another 10 years, probably there will be less and less cars that are using oil.
Mm.
You know, even in the business of oil, they have shale oil that is easier to get. They don't want to rely on Niger Delta militants, you know, and how they affect prices. But at the same time, while we're at it, we need to use that oil resource to diversify our economy. But like you said, we need to be secure. We need to have power.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, if we have electricity, we'll be talking about a different economy because of the innovative, you know, power of our people, and the fact that they are hardworking. Nigerians are hardworking people, regardless of what you think. They're not lazy people.
They're not.
But we have not provided the enabling environment for people to be productive, people to be innovative. We are not supporting farmers. Yes, we dash out fertilizers, but where do the fertilizers end? They end up with politicians who then resell them. We give loans to farmers. Where do they end up? They end up with political chieftains or party chieftains who then give it to who they want after stealing whatever they can steal.
All right, be careful. Language, please, so I'll keep saying this, please.
It's not a problem. I'm a local entity. If I say something you don't like, you can sue me. You know,
all right.
I'll go to court and open a book for them.
Thank you. We need to move on now. When young presidential aspirants came together earlier to form PACT, a coalition that you both were part of, Nigerians were happy, alas, it seems there was light at the end of the tunnel for them. But it all came crumbling like a house of cards. What does this say about the character of an average Nigerian politician, young or old, with respect to the spirit of sportsmanship? I'll start with you, Doctor.
I was part of PACT briefly. I was in there the first meeting. I was there. The second meeting I could not come. My campaign director was there, and the first thing he told me is, "Sir, this looked like a prearranged thing." I said, "Okay." The second meeting I was coming actually was talking.